Harm caused by medicines errors is a worldwide problem. Of the 237 million medication errors that are made every year in England, it's estimated that 1 in 5 are prescribing errors. Here's an extract from an article that appeared in the BMJ. Error rates are lowest in primary care, but because of the sector's size, these amount for nearly 4 out of every 10, that's 38%. Error rates are highest in care homes, 42%, despite covering fewer patients than in the other sectors. Around 1 in 5 medication errors are made in hospitals. The research has estimated that nearly 3 out of 4 medication errors, 72%, are minor, while around 1 in 4, just under 26%, have the potential to cause moderate harm, and just 2% could potentially result in serious harm. Around a third, 34%, of potentially harmful medication errors are made during prescribing in primary care. The researchers calculated that definitely avoidable medication errors cost the NHS nearly £98.5 million every year and 1,708 lives. This is the tip of the iceberg. The BMJ researchers go on to point out that there was simply no UK medication error data available for certain stages of the medication process, or for any stage of the process in care homes. And their calculations didn't include medication errors made by patients or their caregivers, and relied on certain assumptions about the extent of direct harms caused. The NHS in England has a major medicine safety strategy and initiative in process, which I'm sure you're aware of and involved in. The Medicine Safety Improvement Programme is listed in the links section. Here are just some of the initiative's themes. Some questions for reflection. In your area of practice, what are the most likely areas where a prescribing error could be made? Do you discuss these incidents and near misses routinely in your team meetings and peer review sessions? I've added a short handout from the Vale of York CCG, which you might find interesting, to the links section. It's entitled The Top 10 Prescribing Errors in Practice and How to Avoid Them. There are, of course, other areas. One thing I would add to the list myself is the prescribing of intravenous fluids. I'll cover this and show how it was highlighted in the Belfast hyponatremia inquiry in our live sessions. I'd also add, failure to follow the RPS prescribing competency framework is an area that can lead to prescribing errors. There's more on my YouTube site about this and on other critical areas of practice. Finally, by way of personal reflection, I've been particularly influenced by what happened to the wife of Martin Bromley and the clinical human factors approach to patient safety. Watching the video, Just a Routine Operation, is to me as powerful as it ever was. The three components of the clinical human factors approach that stand out for me are, firstly, the way in which in busy and critical situations, we can fail to stand back and therefore lose our situational awareness. This is something that can happen at an organisational level as well as at an individual level. Here is an example I use in my teaching. This is the launch pad underneath the Challenger space shuttle on the day of its launch in 1986. Shortly after takeoff, Challenger was engulfed in a cloud of fire and destroyed. NASA had no experience of launches in such unusually cold temperatures, and there was concern, but this was ignored. Secondly, in the video Just a Routine Operation, you see that although the operating department assistant brought in a tracheostomy kit, everybody referred to the most senior person in the room rather than the person with the most experience of this situation. So this potentially life-saving intervention was ignored. Something to reflect on here is that when dealing with our patients, especially people with long-term conditions and multiple long-term conditions, the most experienced person when it comes to prescribing decisions may be the patient, or their relatives, or if it's a child, it's very likely to be their parents. Finally, the video Just a Routine Operation highlights the importance of the use of checklists and standardised ways of working. These could range from specifically designed protocols for a service to aid memoirs that you've written for yourself and you carry around in your pocket. Do you use checklists in your clinical area? I hope you found this useful, and it provides materials for discussion and reflection. These, of course, can be used in your appraisals, in peer reviews, and for revalidation. You can find a template for reflection here.